Are you looking for cloud architect interview questions or solution architect interview questions? If so, this video is for you. Hi, my name is Michael Gibbs and I'm the founder and CEO of Go Cloud Architects, and we're an organization dedicated towards building high performance cloud computing and networking careers. I've been working in tech now for over 25 years and coaching and mentoring others to get their first tech job or get promoted in tech for 2 decades now, and I've loved every last moment of it. Today we're going to talk about cloud architect interview questions or solutions architect interview questions. And when we describe these, we're going to describe them in a little bit of depth. See, what happens when you go on a cloud architect interview or a solutions architect interview, we're asking these questions to gauge a few things. One, and primarily, is your technical competency, but two is how well you communicate that technology. And three is how well you can actually listen to the question and respond to it. See, these are real critical architecture skills, so we're going to ask them in these interviews, and we're going to do this by asking open-ended questions. So for example, if I were to give someone a question of what is object storage and they answer it S3, that is not a winning answer. If they describe object storage, what it is, how it works, and why an organization would use it, that's going to be a winning answer. And then they can also say, after you know that, here's an AWS implementation of S3, here's a Microsoft Azure implementation called blah. But really what it's about is just knowing, can you describe the technology? Because that's what you're going to be doing as an architect constantly, describing technology to executives, engineers, and architects. So let's go with the question. The first question will be, what is a firewall? How does it work? And why does an organization use it? And really what we're looking to hear is that a firewall is an appliance that keeps bad guys out or intruders out. And it also lets internal users behind the firewall be secure. So let's look at it this way. Think of a firewall as a big wall around a castle, protecting people from coming in. Think of the firewall. But if you had walls around the castle, you wouldn't be able to get out of the castle. So at some point you'd have to open the door to get out and open the door to get in. But if you open the door to get out, it would be open for intruders to get in. So you can't just do that. So firewalls use something called stateful packet inspection. And what does this mean? A firewall, which blocks the perimeter of your network, looks and watches everything that's going on. So by default, firewalls block all incoming traffic that's generated externally. But firewalls allow internal traffic to traverse the firewall and come back. So how do they do that? Firewalls are what's called stateful. So here's what that actually means. Here's my firewall. Here's me. I want to go to www.gocloudcareers.com. I go from my PC through the firewall to the internet. It gets routed to the web server that's handling my system, and then comes back. The web server answers my request. And yet the firewall miraculously lets my traffic in. So why? See, what's going on is the firewall is watching my connection. As soon as I pierce through the firewall, it knows my source address and destination IP address, protocols, and port numbers. And it tracks that. It puts it into a table. So then when I traverse that, say I send a SYN to an external web server to open a connection, a TCP connection, and the web server responds to my SYN with an ACK and then generates the SYN to open the connection on the other end, the firewall watched it. The firewall knows because the firewall is stateful. So that's what we mean by stateful packet inspection. It's watching what's going on and then it allows a return. So organizations use firewalls to protect the perimeter of the network. Firewalls are configured by default to block all incoming traffic except that you enable. So by policy, you determine what you allow in, if any, and the firewall lets your outbound traffic return. So organizations use it to protect the perimeter of the network to enhance their security, using the network, using the data center, and using the cloud. Now you know what is a firewall, how it works, and why you would use them. Now this next question pops up a lot. When do you use an application load balancer versus a network load balancer? And you know, people struggle with this and there's really no reason. We find that people that come from an application development background automatically think of an application load balancer. And we find that people like me that are used to designing high performance networks use network load balancers. But let's break it down into something more than that. An application load balancer and a network load balancer are similar and different in certain ways. In that they are both similar in that they load balance between certain things. They are dissimilar with regards to the intelligence and their speed and performance. So an application load balancer is really, really smart. It's looking at layer 7 of the OSI model, looking at things in the header, and it is very intelligent. because it'll look at all parts of an HTTP or HTTPS header, and it can do some very intelligent routing. So if your performance needs are low and you're trying to route between, say, microservices or certain containers that are small, use an application load balancer. It's super smart. Now, what happens when you ask something to do a lot of work? It's slow. What happens if you ask something to do something very minimal? It's fast. So if you need performance, for example, you use a network load balancer. Network load balancers, which operate at layer 4, are very fast because all they do is they map the flows for the most part. Source, destination, address, protocol, port number, boom, in and out, in and out, in and out. And because of that, they're really fast. So routing between microservices, needing a lot of intelligence, use an application load balancer. High performance routing, high performance movement of your data, share it with a network load balancer. Now you know which one to use. This next question pops up on all kinds of certification exams, but it's also something that we may ask to see if someone's actually worked with the network before. The question is, how long does it take to transfer an organization's data over the WAN connection? See, let's say you want to migrate to the cloud. You need to take your data from your data center and move it to the cloud. And there's lots of ways you can do it. You can use it with transfer appliances, send your files directly over. You can basically receive a hard drive and send a hard drive over, or you can receive a ruggedized computer plus hard drive and send it over, or you can just use your network. So let's talk about how long it's going to take over the network, because the time that you have and the speed that you have will determine whether you can use the network or whether you need something different, like an AWS Snowball, for example, or a huge environment in AWS Snowmobile. So let's calculate it out. So here's what you do. Let's say you have a gigabit per second WAN link. That means you can transfer a gigabit per second. But wait, data is actually bytes, not bits. So now first thing you need to do is take your 1,000 megabit and divide by 8, because there's 8 bits to a byte. Now that gets you your megabit per second rate. So now take your megabit per second rate, multiply that by 60, because there's 60 seconds in a minute. Now again, multiply that by 60 again, because there's 60 minutes in an hour, and then multiply that by 24. Now guess what? You know exactly how much data you can transfer in one day, very simply. Now that you know this, let's say you have a certain amount of data, take the amount of data you have, divide it by the amount of data per day, and you will know how many days it will take to get your data from point A to point B. That's it. That's how you know how long it will take to transfer your data. So if you're ever posed an exam question or an interview question that says you've got a certain amount of data and a certain amount of time, what should you do? You now know how to calculate it. So, wonderful. Now let's talk about non-transitive routing. What is non-transitive routing and why am I asking these questions? When you're dealing with IBGP in the networking world, you're dealing with a lot of non-transitive routing. But when you're in cloud computing, you're also dealing with non-transitive routing. Why is this? The cloud providers want to work hard to make sure that you don't make your organization transit to the entire world. So here's what non-transitive routing is. Let's say I'm B, router B, or organization B in the middle. We've got organization A to the left of me, organization B to the right of me, and of course this may be actually flipped because of the camera, but where my left hand is actually at, see, this is organization A, I'm organization B, and where my right hand is at, we'll call this organization C. In order for A to reach me and C, I need to make sure that each person knows each other's routing information. So if C gives me its routing information and I pass C's routing information to A, A knows how to reach C. Now if A sends his information to me and to B, me, and I send it to C, now they can both reach each other. That is fully transitive routing. What is non-transitive routing? If I take in A's routes and I take in C's routes, and I know how to reach A because I have A's routes and A has mine, and C knows how to reach me because it has his routes and mine, but A and C don't know each other's routes, that's non-transitive routing, which means I can talk to A and I can talk to C, but A can't talk to C through me. That is non-transitive routing. So let's look about what you could do about these kind of things. In BGP, the traditional environment, IBGP, we use something called a route reflector. And what was a route reflector? Something that broke the rules of non-transitive routing. So A would teach me, or would send a route to me, B. B would send it to C. C would send it to B. And B would send it to A. And all of a sudden, everybody can talk to everybody. Now, that's great when you want them to. But if you don't want them to, that's a problem because you become transit for people. So when you're dealing with the cloud providers and you're connecting multiple multiple VPCs, what they do is they prevent them from exchanging each other's routing information for both security purposes, as well as to make sure you don't become transit for multiple partner organizations. So how do you do that on the cloud? Let's say you're on AWS, for example, and you've got a VPC peer to multiple organizations. Of course, you could fully mesh them, just like you did with IBGP. And with IBGP, we came up with a solution called the Route Reflector. And when you're dealing with cloud providers, let's take AWS, they have things like Cloud Hub and Transit Gateway. What is Cloud Hub and Transit Gateway? Almost effectively the same Route Reflector technology, although the implementations and what they support are different. Basically, it means that if C, VPC C, sends me, VPC B, its routing information, and I pass it to VPC A, its routing information, then they can all reach each other. So what happens with these transit gateways and cloud hubs is they permit transitive routing, they break the rules of non-transitive routing by allowing to go through, and everybody has reachability, which enables you to create a hub and spoke routing environment with VPC pairing in the cloud. Now, since we talked about the routing and the complexities of this, what is VPC pairing? Well, we're going to tell you right now. So when we ask someone what is VPC pairing, we're trying to find out if they actually know first what is a VPC and why organizations would pair that with other organizations or themselves. So what VPC pairing is you take an organization's virtual private cloud and you connect it to another organization's virtual private cloud and you exchange routing information and services between them. And in the process, you enable them to talk to each other. So let's look at why you might want to do VPC pairing. Let's say, for an example, you are a retail store. Let's say you have a partner organization that you buy your supplies from, and they also purchase certain things from you. You could peer your organization with somebody else's virtual private cloud, ride over the AWS network, for example, leverage the high performance network that AWS has, and communicate to each other in a private and secure manner. So what is VPC pairing? VPC pairing is used to connect one organization to another organization, leveraging the benefits of the network supported by the cloud provider in a rapid and secure and fast manner. I hope you've enjoyed these AWS Solutions Architect interview questions or Cloud Architect interview questions. Let me tell you about some things that we do for the Cloud Architect community. On every Monday and every Thursday, we have a completely free How to Get Your First Cloud Architect Job webinar. And on this webinar, we tell you everything you need to do to get hired, what you need to learn, what employers desire, what to put on your resume, how to interview, and everything that you need to do. We do this completely free on Mondays and Thursdays. Now on every Tuesdays, we have an absolute fun Cloud Architect Experience webinar. And you know what we do on these webinars? We invite you to come in. You will get a chance to live the life of a cloud architect and find out if you're job ready. And if not, you'll know exactly what you need to learn. We will bring you in, you will interview me, I will present a technical challenge and a business challenge. You will take that information, you'll work with a team of people on the phone or on the Zoom call, and you will literally design a solution for me, and then you will present it back to me just like you would as a real architect. So come and join us, it's completely free, we do it every Tuesday. Now most Wednesdays we do a completely free Cloud Architect Career question and answer session. And on this question and answer session, you bring us any questions you have and we'll answer them real time. We do it as a service for free for the cloud computing community. And on a lot of Wednesdays, we do a multi-hour live stream, live educational thing on a cloud technology or a network technology. So please subscribe and hit the bell and you'll get to find this out. In the coming weeks and months, you're going to see a lot more people on our channel. We have large numbers of connections with experts in the industry, and we're going to bring people in to help share their perspectives so you get to hear from other cloud providers. We want to provide you the absolute best free cloud computing information or networking information to build your cloud computing or networking career. I want to thank you so much for watching this video, and I look forward to seeing you in another video very soon. Thank you and take care.